If you open any acoustics textbook, you are going to find in the very first chapters the definition of sound levels expressed in decibel. And actually you're going to find two definitions. One is called the sound pressure level, which is defined as 20 times the logarithm of the RMS value of the pressure divided by a reference value, which is set at 2 × 10⁻⁵ Pascal, and a second definition of a sound intensity level, which is defined as 10 times the log of the active intensity, total active intensity, divided by a reference value, which is of 10⁻¹² watts per square meter, or 1 picowatt per square meter. In this video, I'd like to give you some arguments for indeed using a logarithmic scale for measuring the noise level, and I will try to explain you what is the difference between the sound pressure level and sound intensity level. To introduce that, we have to go back to the 19th century, where a German scientist, Weber, launched a new field of research called psychophysics. The idea was to try to reconcile actual measurements of physical quantities like weights, sounds, and any other phenomenon you can think of, and the perception that we humans have of that perception. In fact, Weber didn't really work on sounds, but one of his important experiments was on weight. You see this athlete lifting a very heavy weight W, and the question is, how much weight should we add in order for the person to actually feel the difference? If he's carrying 100 kilos and you add 1 gram, it's very likely that he will not see a difference. And Weber made a lot of experiments and discovered that there is indeed a limit that he called the difference limen. The word comes from the Latin word limes, limitis, which means border, boundary, frontier, limit. He discovered that there is indeed in all phenomena a limit, a threshold, a difference limen, below which you don't feel the additional weight and above which you indeed start to feel it. And what Weber also discovered is that this difference limen is not a constant. If you double the weight, you actually double the extra weight you have to add for making a difference. And so the Weber law just says that the difference limen is proportional to the initial state. The additional weight that you have to add to make a difference is proportional to the original weight. So delta W, DL, so the limit value of delta W is equal to a constant, which depends on the type of stimulus. It's different for a sound and for a weight, but it's a constant, and this constant is multiplied by the reference weight. It shouldn't actually be too surprising. Think, for instance, in terms of money and salary raise. What is the minimum salary raise that you have to give someone to get him motivated? Well, if you earn 1,000 euro a month, you'll probably be happy to get 100 euro more. But if you're earning 10,000 euro a month, you probably won't be very motivated if you get less than 1,000 euro more. So it's the same idea. And I can also give you an optical equivalent. You see here 10 dots in a square. If I show you now a second square with 20 dots, so I've added 10 dots, it's obvious that the density of dots in the square has increased, and this increase is perfectly visible. But if I now start with 110 points and add 10 points, you barely see the difference. So 10 points is meaningful in one circumstance and is not meaningful in another circumstance. But the Weber law in itself is not sufficient for explaining the use of a logarithmic scale in acoustics. We have to add a second psychophysical law discovered by one of the students of Weber, Fechner. The idea of Fechner, which is very classical now in psychophysics, is that when you are facing a stimulus S, the way you actually identify the level or the perceived level of that stimulus is by starting from the lowest stimulus that you can feel and then going step by step towards the actual stimulus, going up one different limen at a time. So the idea of Weber is that you create a staircase, starting on the lowest stimulus that you can feel, and you just count the steps that takes you to the actual stimulus you are faced with. Mathematically, if we call psi the perception that you have of a given stimulus S, well, if you have an increase of the stimulus DS, the corresponding increase in the perception that you have, because it is related to the number of different limen, well, then D psi, the variation in perception, is equal to the variation in stimulus DS divided by that different limen. And it's there that the Weber law comes in, because we know, according to Weber, that the different limen is proportional to the initial stimulus. You see that we have a relationship that says that D psi, the variation in perception, is equal to DS, the variation in stimulus, divided by KS. If you now want to evaluate the absolute perception, you have to integrate that quantity from the sensitivity threshold, from the lowest perception stimulus that you can feel, S0, to the actual stimulus SA, and the integral obviously gives you 1 over K times the log of SA over S0. And you see here where the logarithmic definition of the sound level comes. It simply comes from the application of the Weber law and the Fechner law, which says that the perceived level of a stimulus S is equal to a constant times the logarithm of the actual stimulus divided by a reference value, and this reference value corresponds to the smallest stimulus that you are able to perceive. We now have to decide whether the acoustic stimulus is the pressure or the intensity. Well, actually it's both. These are two relevant quantities that provide different information about the sound field. Maybe it's good to make an analogy with a heater. Suppose that I have a heater in this room, and well, I can describe two quantities. At a given point, I can look at the temperature, which is very important, tells me exactly how hot it is at a given position, but I can also look at the heat flux, which tells me how much heat goes through this point at a given time. Well, pressure and intensity is the same thing. Pressure tells me what is the sound pressure, what is the signal that I can hear at a given position, while the intensity is telling me at the same point how much energy, how much power is propagating from the source to the receiver. In a way, you can think that the intensity distribution characterizes the sources, which is the cause of sound, and the sound pressure level tells you what is the effect of the source at a given position. Therefore, there is a reason for calculating a sound pressure level and the sound intensity level. But to understand exactly how they are formulated, we have to go back to the definition of the intensity. We've seen that active intensity can be expressed as 1/2 times the real part of the pressure spectrum times the complex conjugate of the velocity spectrum. But we have also introduced a very important acoustical quantity called the impedance, which is defined as the ratio of the pressure spectrum to the velocity spectrum. Therefore, I can write the velocity, or the complex conjugate of the velocity, as the complex conjugate of the pressure spectrum divided by the complex conjugate of the impedance. And if I put that into the definition of the intensity, I see that active intensity is proportional to P squared divided by 2 times the real part of 1 over Z star. And P squared divided by 2 is the RMS pressure, root mean square average value of the pressure. So that a general expression for active intensity is that it is equal to the RMS pressure multiplied by a constant that is the real part of 1 over the complex conjugate of the impedance. This is important to understand a key difference at the beginning between sound intensity level and sound pressure level. In a sound intensity level, the definition is that the level of intensity in dB is 10 times the logarithm of I divided by I0. So the active intensity divided by a reference value, which corresponds, as we've seen before, to the lowest intensity that, on average, we are able to perceive. And if you look at the definition of the sound pressure level, it is not 10 times the log of something, it is 20 times the log of the RMS pressure divided by a reference value. And the 20 comes simply from the fact that intensity is proportional to the square of the pressure, and therefore to have consistent, not equal, but consistent scale for the sound pressure and sound intensity level, we have to take 20 times the log. It's related to the fact that if you double the pressure, you multiply the intensity by 4, and you want to have something consistent here. Then you look at the reference value. For intensity, it's 10 minus 12 watt per square meter, and in pressure, it's 210 minus 5 Pascal. How was the reference value for the pressure chosen? Well, it was chosen so that the sound pressure level and sound intensity level have the same value in one important specific case, which is the case of a plane wave. In a plane wave, the impedance, as we've seen in the classroom, the impedance of a plane wave is equal to rho times c, the air density times the speed of sound. So that the relationship between intensity and pressure in a plane wave is that active intensity is the square of the RMS pressure divided by rho c. And therefore, we decide to set the reference value of the pressure so that it gives exactly the same intensity level, the same intensity level. And therefore, we have the relationship that 10 minus 12 watt per square meter, which is the reference value of intensity, is equal to 210 minus 5 squared, which is the square of the reference value chosen, divided by rho c, so 1.225 times 340. So now we have a complete picture. We know why we have two indicators, we know why they are different, but we also know how the reference value were chosen. I need to tell you one more thing. We introduce a third sound level, which is the sound power level. The power is simply the integral over a surface, a relevant surface, of the flux of intensity. And the sound power level is just defined like the sound intensity level as 10 times the log of W divided by a reference value, which is chosen at 10 minus 12 watts. So the flux of the reference intensity through a surface of 1 square meter. To conclude this lecture, we will just ask one final question. Is the Weber law actually applicable in acoustics? And to do that, we have to look at literature, and there are generations of psychoacousticians who have measured the different Schliemann for different frequencies, different levels in different conditions. And here I'm just relying on a work by Houtsma, which shows the measured different Schliemann as a function of the reference level for two different sounds, a white noise and a tonal noise. A white noise is a noise that contains a sound that contains all frequencies in equal proportions. We will define that better in one of the coming videos. And a tonal noise is a noise characterized by a well-defined single frequency. And what you see on this graph is that at best, Weber's law is a good idealization in the case of the white noise, because the red curve that you see and the green curve that you see match reasonably well, but that it's not a good approximation at, for the tonal noise, and definitely it's not a good approximation in for very low stimuli. But nevertheless, it's a fair approximation for white noise, and it's on that basis that the logarithmic scale has been introduced.